Well, dudes and dudettes, the day is finally here. The final installment of the Gecko series, and one that is very interesting to say the least.
It sucks to see it happen, but yeah, ever since my admittedly screwed up review of the first game back in 2014, this will probably be the last time we ever take a look at the Gecko series here on this channel. So without beating around the bush now, what exactly inspired the creation of the third Gex game beyond the success of Gex 3D and the Gecko? After doing a bit of digging, not much, but there was an effort made to streamline Deep Cover Gecko's level design. Namely in the collectathon aspects, as not many players were exactly thrilled with the collection aspect of gold and silver emotes. So to rectify this complaint, the gameplay is now more centered around completing the different objectives in terms of getting the main remotes that you'd receive at the end of the level. And on top of that, Crystal Dynamics also wanted to emphasize Gex's personality through the character's animations, alongside opening up the hub world significantly so that the hub world itself would feel like a level that you could discover hidden secrets in. In another bizarre coincidence, it seems that yet another water level was cut out from Gex 3, as a level called Fish Frequency was part of the 1998 prototype demo for Gex 3 that never made it into the final game. And so, without much else to speak of, on March 23rd, 1998, Gex 3 Deep Cover Gecko was released to a public that, while considering the game to be good, it wasn't exactly anything that blew anybody away.
This is a game that, while I do like it, it has always been a game that, well, I really don't know how to articulate, so let's just take a look at the story and see what the final chapter of the Gex Thrilogy has in store for us.
So the plot kicks off as such.
And that's how the cabinet minister got his trousers back. What's this? Ladies and gentlemen, I've just been handed some late breaking news. Special Agent Extra, head of the TV Terrorist Defense Unit, and star of many of my private dreams, is apparently missing.
Jumpin' Jerry Springer!
Agent Extra was last seen wearing 8-inch heels and a red bathing suit. Her current whereabouts are unknown.
Gex. Gex!
Agent Extra? You poor kidnapped minx.
Hey, Tiger. Guess where I am? Trapped in the media dimension. Rez is back and he's kidnapped me to get to you. He's attacking your secret island gate.
Hey, speaking of secrets, you want to see my...
Gex, quit clowning around and get me out of here. This place is giving me the creeps. Just dial me in.
If you're calling from a touchtone phone, please press 1 now.
Gex, listen up. Keep your watch on at all times so I can call you. Meanwhile, get me out of here. I need you.
You and every other beautiful government agent trapped in a TV set. I'm on my way. Schlemiel, Schlemazel. Hey, that tingles. Rez, get ready for the ultimate gecko weapon, baby. Yeah.
And like with the previous games, that's pretty much the story.
Look, if it wasn't obvious enough by this point, Gex really isn't a narratively driven series, so I realize looking for story depth where there is none is quite pointless. But as someone who does genuinely love the series, part of me wonders if this wasn't the ultimate gift and curse ever bestowed upon the franchise. On the plus side, having a series dedicated to nothing but jokes and references does eliminate the desire to look for plot holes and character inconsistencies to focus more on the general theme of what they want to parody. In this case, continuing the James Bond theme that was seen in Enter the Gecko.
On the other hand though, it also gives the Gex series a real lack of identity as a result.
With all Gex has to go on being TV-watching lizard does TV parody things, Gex loses a little bit when it comes to franchise longevity. Something which quite clearly makes itself known in how the franchise's source material is really only as strong as the jokes it can make. Now, while this can apply to the franchise as a whole, no more is this apparent than how it impacts Deep Cover Gecko's story beyond the initial premise. And this is namely in how a lack of context can affect how one cares when it comes to giving the player a reason to get invested in the gameplay. And in this case, it really just comes down to the fact that our only real motivation for playing is to rescue Agent Extra. Who is Agent Extra? Why should we care? And how does she know Gex? The game tells us none of this, her cutscenes only really existing after you beat a level for the sake of innuendos and jokes. So ultimately, the story is only really good if you find it funny, which in this case depends upon how much you enjoy Gex's quotes.
The point that I'm trying to make here is that this is the folly of what a lot of 3D platformer games really do suffer in terms of story, and if you're beginning to wonder why 3D platformers went into decline in the mid-2000s and why they aren't exactly around anymore besides a few niche titles here and there, well, this is kind of the answer to that.
Not all 3D platformers, mind you. Some like, say, the Jak and Daxter series or Sly Raccoon, among many others, do work on contextual and story energy. But when it comes to very simplistic platformers like Gex, games that work on more of a theme rather than a cast of characters or a narrative worth investing in, this is where, depending on the developer's passion for the game or care that they have for the series, you'll find it vanishing into the ether just as quickly as it came. You play the game, you beat it, Rez dies... again. In less impressive fashion than he was last time, given the fact that we at least had the revelation of Rez being Gex's dad previously. And then the game ends with Marlys Andrada having sex with a lizard.
As I was saying, Extra, my love, it's tail time.
Come here, you silly gecko. Oh, Gex.
Thank you for that.
So with the thought of woman on gecko action, let's move on to less perverse postures.
Onto the gameplay side of things, everything from controls, mission structure, and overall thematics seen in Enter the Gecko make their return here and in more or less pretty decent fashion to boot. While the game doesn't exactly reinvent the steel in terms of refining the gameplay mechanics or controls, the camera is now pulled back from Gex's character model, and the annoying cuckoo noise that was seen previously has now been done away with. To go a little bit deeper into Gex's movements, they feel a little bit more... chunkier than they did before. Nothing that makes the game feel sluggish, mind you. However, while Enter the Gecko felt floatier when you were trying to navigate around platform structures, here it feels like his movement speed is a little bit more reduced by a small margin. The fly power-ups are back again, and in equally limited selection as they were in Enter the Gecko. The fire-spinning power-up makes its reappearance, requiring you to go into a first-person aiming mode, where you aim at targets and take out whatever enemies, structural weak points, or whatever mission objectives the mission requires. Similarly, also comes the ice power-up, freezing enemies in place, and giving you the ability to use them as platforms akin to what you had in the first Gex game. But this was stuff that you've already known at this point, so what exactly does Gex 3 specifically bring to the table in terms of new content? Well, for one thing, the interactive elements, Gex riding a snowboard, driving a tank, or going swimming, all fitting within their retrospective context to complete a level. Not terrible, but at the same time not exactly worth rushing out to buy a copy of the game for these elements alone. But to their credit, they are nice pace breakers between long stretches of platforming. Another thing to talk about will be the context-sensitive costume power-ups. Some are merely for aesthetic, but some are also used for gliding, like the Gundam suit Gex gets in the anime channel, or the Dracula outfit, or the strength that Gex gets in... the Mythology Network.
Look, we'll cross that bridge when we get to it, so for the time being, let's just cover the general gameplay first.
In the effort to make collectibles something more tangible to get in the game, without making them feel like you have to get them for the sake of completion, we have the addition of bonus and poor coins. The bonus coins being used to unlock bonus missions after you get a certain amount of them, and the poor coins being used to add an extra hit point to Gex's health once you collect 25 of them. While the main fly coin collectibles seen in the first game look a lot less varied compared to Gex 3D Enter the Gecko, here their use is a lot less tedious since you are incentivized to pick them up, as getting 50 of them will grant you an extra life, and by getting 100 fly coins, you get a fourth remote for that specific mission, just in case you didn't feel like playing through some of the more bullshit missions later on in the game.
Like Enter the Gecko, you only have to get a certain amount of remotes so you can access the final boss, so if you're not one for 100% completion, then this is definitely a plus in my book, as it gives the player more options on how to go about specific levels they like and the levels that they don't.
As is, the inclusion of bonus and poor coins make for a nice incentive to pick them up, while not exactly essential. But it is nice enough that they do give you a reason to go after them, and on top of that, bonus levels upon completing them also give you access to codes that you can use within the vault inside the Gecko Cave. And speaking of the Gex Cave, with the developer's intent to make the hub world feel like a living, breathing level of its own, there are plenty of hidden secrets such as bonus levels, enemies to defeat, costumes to access, and as well as specific areas based upon the levels that you go through. And this includes the secret missions, where upon getting all the fly coins, you're granted an emblem which will bring you one step closer to unlocking the vault. And I suppose while I'm on that subject, the secret missions themselves also contain secret cutscenes that you can view after the level's complete.
Do they add anything to the overall story?
I love the smell of bugs. Victory!
You think I'm funny? You laughing at me? You want a piece of me?
This town ain't big enough for the both of us.
So in other words, not a goddamn thing.
Still, for as pointless as those cutscenes are, they do look nice in a very 90s nostalgic FMV CG kind of way, and it does still kind of make for a better reward than what you get for playing through... the Mythology Network. But at least in the meantime, you are still given some pretty cool secret levels to play around with the grimy urban theme similar to In Dragnet, alongside a level based on Akuji the Heartless.
Well, it's something I appreciated anyway, as one of five people who've actually played the game.
Getting back on topic, however, while the Gex Cave itself might come across as one big labyrinthian, overly sparse level that's a little bit larger than it needs to be, it's nothing too strenuous if you're just looking to play through the main levels and call it a day, and plus the aesthetics of each new area give it a nice sense of progression as they reflect the specific level tropes that they're based around. Which is something that I can give the game over the cyberpunk theme of Gex 1, or the weird Greek god dimension scene in Enter the Gecko.
But I think I've beaten around the bush enough, so the main levels. How are they and how do they stack up to the previous game?
In terms of level themes, Deep Cover Gecko still goes for that pop cultural pastiche of many differing parodies, but nothing so specific that a major movie corporation would give Crystal Dynamics the evil eye and threaten legal action with. And right here we have Holiday Broadcasting, Mystery TV, The Oregon Trail, Tut TV, The Army Channel, The Buccaneer Program, Fairy Tales TV, The Anime Channel, Gangster TV, Superhero Show, and lastly, The Mythology Network. Like last time, you're given a set of three mission-specific objectives based upon the level themes. And while very similar to the previous games in terms of structure, there is something about Deep Cover Gecko's atmosphere that makes these levels feel more immersive. It's something that can actually be said about the game as a whole, with how the level aesthetics alone really help immerse the player into the vibe of the TV show they're currently going through. And particular points of interest do come with the anime channel's pastiche of Gundam and shoujo anime levels, with the cheerful action vibe represented by Gex's outfit and the attack of the Japanese schoolgirls. The Oregon Trail having a surprisingly intense Wild West vibe as you travel under cover of darkness with thunderstorms and moonlight all about, against dangerous ghosts and scorpions that get in your way as you travel through the underground mines. Mystery TV doing a great job at melding ancient Sir Arthur Conan Doyle literature, with a dash of Bram Stoker's Dracula thrown in there. Tut TV, while taking on a very generic desert theme, makes great use of the ambient lighting and trippy visuals like the Sphinx faces that come out of the wall to take a bite out of you. Gangster TV being one of my favourite levels in the game, doing a fantastic job with being a gritty 1930s Italian mafia level, with the sunrisen New York backdrop making for one hell of an awesome level to play through. I think what it comes down to is really the fact that I think the parodies are more distinctive and diverse this time around, and it really does get you invested in the levels in a way that Gex 1 and Enter the Gecko's more broad strokes sort of attempt could never really achieve for me. And I think it's because of this increased immersion that I honestly get a major kick out of exploring the levels and finding all sorts of hidden goodies, whether visual comedy or the parody advertisements that you can see in the level. Or hell, even just down to how the game really does sell the idea that you as Gex are traveling through this level, which adapts its material around the game in a parodial tone without necessarily being too self-referential or detached about the whole thing.
It's a rule that is so often broken when it comes to games that break the fourth wall, and if there's one thing that I can respect about the Gex series, is that no matter how over the top and parodial it gets, it never undercuts the atmosphere of the level that it's trying to parody.
Mainly because Gex himself is still trying to complete his mission, and despite the fact that he and his butler Alfred can travel into the media dimension so freely, there is a reason as to why he can be so self-referential rather than just act that way for the sake of lol so wacky. Investment and context to me is key for making or breaking how memorable a level is, and while compared to the previous two games, Deep Cover Gecko feels to me, well, a lot less video gamey than the likes of Enter the Gecko and Gex 1. Not to say that the previous two games' attempts at this were bad, mind you, but to me, their broad strokes approach always felt so shaky from a contextual standpoint, and the fact that they had a tendency to reuse tropes and level assets really didn't help in this aspect. Deep Cover Gecko, on the other hand, goes for all new levels, and as a result, each environment feels unique and more specifically designed for what they were trying to parody, rather than reusing Scream TV or the very generic prehistoric level assets for the fourth time. It's slightly more understandable for Gex 1, since that game is running on the Panasonic 3DO, but the fact that Deep Cover Gecko goes for more immersive levels compared to Enter the Gecko is a major step up in my opinion. But I'm getting off topic, so I'll get back to the game's tone when we cover the technical aspects. Throughout the levels, you'll come across two unlockable characters, Rex and Cuz. Rex being a T-Rex frozen out of time, which you will find in the Holiday Broadcasting level.
You know, the usual place you'd expect to find a T-Rex, in the middle of Santa's workshop.
And by thawing him out, you get the ability to play as him during the secret missions, in place of Gex if you so choose to. The same thing goes with Cuz, Gex's cousin who I guess was taken hostage by the Mafia, and upon freeing him from a cargo ship, he's also an unlockable character in the secret missions.
And if you would like to learn more about their incredibly deep personalities and incredibly rich backstories, well, allow me to tell you everything about them.
If there was anything negative I had to critique about the gameplay, my only major gripes would really be with a few select levels like Superhero Show feeling very indistinct. The second point of criticism really being for the Fly Coin missions to get a fourth remote, being very stingy about collecting every single Fly Coin in the level, which can be a massive pain in the ass, despite the fact that it is an alternative way of getting some extra remotes if you feel so inclined to track them down. And lastly, the boss fights, which to me degrade in quality the further we go on. You start off fighting against the Rock Hard.
You smell what the Rock is cooking?
Shut up.
Avoid his elbow drop and whack him with your tail. That's about it. I will say this though, I mean, I do love the wrestling ring atmosphere and the cool music that plays. Next up being the Brain of Oz.
And now, Skully's fun fact of the- oh shit, I'm already wearing my sunnies. Anyway, this boss was cut out of Gex 3D and the Gecko due to time constraints.
And what we have here is hitting the cannon to shoot him while occasionally dodging his attacks and his little minions that he sends out. But strategy-wise, this does feel pretty weak, and I'd just like to remind you all that we're a little over halfway done with the game at this point. And last up is Rez, not only taking place in a terrible James Bond movie with Moonraker, but the build-up and atmosphere does not hold a candle at all to the final boss fight of Enter the Gecko. And once you bust your way into Rez's space station for an Empire Strikes Back-style boss fight, all you're really doing is just shooting the obvious weak spot before Rez dies for realsies.
What's that? You wanted to hear about how Rez being Gex's father had an effect on anything? Well, fuck you, because the game doesn't care. Except apparently that Rez wanted to seduce Marlise Andrada with a marathon of Star Trek movies?
He asked me to marry him. Actually, he insisted.
That's my dad! Good thing I got you out of there when I did!
Seriously, what is it with Gex's family desiring women they're biologically incompatible with? You know, whatever, this doesn't really bear thinking about, and I've spent way too much time thinking about the moral implications of this. So, overall thoughts on the gameplay is that it's pretty good, so let's move on to the technical aspect so we can-
Well, I guess there's no escaping it now. Let's take a look at the Mythology Network. Right after this commercial break.
In terms of combat, the Matrix Path of Neo works in its own unique way by combining the usage of analog stick and button inputs to-
You're not buying this for a second, are you? Fine, this time for realsies, let's finally get into the Mythology Network.
Now, on the whole, there is a lot that I do like about the Mythology Network. The level aesthetics look great, the inspiration mixture of Odysseus, Jason and the Argonauts, and Hercules is fantastic, and had a few things been done differently, this honestly would have been one of my favorite levels in the game.
But it's here where we come into the problem of level design.
A major point of criticism, which kinda comes and goes depending on my mood, is how levels can sometimes feel like they drag on after a certain point. A part of this is me also trying to get the 100 fly coins for a fourth remote, so I don't entirely blame this level that much for my tedium, but another part is also the sparse level design and how it can lead to a very lengthy trek across the level to complete an objective that should be as simple as find the TV to get out of the level. The Buccaneer program and superhero shows are also examples of this to a lesser extent, but other levels in the game like Tut TV, the anime channel and the Orkin Trail, and Holiday Broadcasting all do a good job of avoiding this by adding in a bit of visual flair and gameplay elements to keep the player invested. Whether it says parody elements within the missions themselves or any sort of visual flair they have, they all end up feeling very in line with what the level's based on and trying to parody, so as a result, it sustains its gimmick without wearing out its welcome. Not the Mythology Network though, this level not only drags, but its missions are a pain in the ass. The mission objectives themselves are nothing out of the ordinary. Collect 3 golden apples, smash 5 statues, and get to the TV at the end of the rainbow. But this part of the game, and one that appropriately enough, feels very Spartan in terms of being a naked example of platforming, with little else in the way of parody material. There's very little in the way of getting a feel for the environment since it's all basically just pillars, clouds, and grass, which is about as generic as a platformer could get, and had it not been for the ancient Greek-looking enemies and aesthetics, this really wouldn't be much to talk about. Second to this would be the tedious usage of essential power-ups like the Ice Fly power-up to get up to certain platforms, and the Hercules power-up which you need to use your strength to smash down and move platforms into position with very limited time to use these power-ups before you have to get them again.
So just picture having to go back and forth each and every time the Hercules power runs up to either smash a statue or push some blocks into place. Yeah, not very fun, is it?
Never mind the fact that it usually takes a little bit to trek back to the platforms themselves, but it's a level that just feels so monotonous in the fact that you have to constantly go back and search for apples, search for statues to smash, and to be perfectly honest though, I don't blame you for skipping this level. In fact, you know what? I highly recommend that you do so for the sake of your sanity. Again, I could go on for hours about the Mythology Network being a terrible level, but again, after that point, it's pretty smooth sailing from there on out.
So with that Greek tragedy out of the way, let's finally move into the technical aspects.
Compared to Gex 3D Enter the Gecko, Gex 3 looks about on par with its predecessor from a graphical standpoint. However, one major improvement all around would be the game's ambient lighting, and not just for the darker stages either. Whether it be the gritty sunrise of Gangster TV or the vibrant and bright anime channel, this game makes a much greater effort this time around to add a nice little touch to the level with the lighting, giving off a very fitting tone for the levels that Gex is running and jumping through. And just like before, the game's soundtrack is appropriately emulating what it's trying to parody. The first of these tasty tracks being the theme to Gangster TV. The boss music for pretty much all the bosses in the game. Mystery TV. Blood-pumping excellence of the anime channel. Tut TV. Spit It Out by Slipknot.
I wasn't actually in the game, I just wanted to see if you were paying attention.
But take it from me, dudes and dudettes, this soundtrack is fantastic. Dana Gould makes his return from the American versions of the game as Gex, however, for the PAL regions, Leslie Phillips is nowhere to be found.
So, without the dulcet tones of Leslie Phillips, who could you possibly get to voice Gex, who was as cool and smooth that could possibly live up to Gex's name in the final installment?
How am I looking?
Yes, it's Danny John Jules, ladies and gentlemen.
Dangerous!
And to my honest opinion, I honestly think his voice perfectly fits Gex.
Part of this may be my bias due to the fact that I love him as the cat in Red Dwarf, but there are a few reasons as to why I do enjoy Danny's portrayal of the character. Namely that, unlike Leslie Phillips, who I'll admit does have a very badass voice for Gex, it isn't exactly fitting for the character in a general sense, only really working if you're going for him as the sort of straight-up James Bond parody type. So for me, it mainly comes down to how much I think Danny John Jules really captures the energy of the Gex character, without going needlessly over the top and screechy like Dana Gould had a tendency of doing from time to time. And last up on our cast list is Marlise Andrada as Agent Extra, who's not bad, but was quite clearly marketed for sex appeal given the game's advertisements. I doubt this was a career high point for her, but all the same, it's nothing too bad. With the possible exception of some, uncomfortable implications about the game's ending. Speaking of which though, one thing that does majorly contrast with Enter the Gecko's more neutral tone is how adult Deep Cover Gecko's tone feels. It's nothing too crass, mind you. It doesn't exactly get as juvenile as a game like, say, Conker's Bad Fur Day, for example, but the game itself does go for more of a tone that has a little bit of bite to it, and it's something that I can appreciate. You'll see a little bit of blood, a little bit of grit in the levels themselves, but all laced together with a snarky bite of humor to keep you laughing. It's the kind of tone that I think makes sense for a series like Gex, which allows the jokes to be a lot more hard-hitting without the need to censor themselves, which to me greatly aids the game's presentation.
So with all that out of the way, what are my final thoughts on Gex 3 Deep Cover Gecko?
Gex 3 Deep Cover Gecko is an interesting game for me to say the least. There are parts of the game that I do like better than Enter the Gecko, like the more focused gameplay and grittier presentation. There are a few drawbacks to this though. Some missions being absolute rubbish, like the Mythology Network, and the story as a whole being very been there, done that, even by Gex standards. I don't know, I mean, these two games are really neck and neck for me, but if I was to give a final opinion on Deep Cover Gecko, I'd definitely say that I like the game on equal standing with Enter the Gecko. In terms of recommendations, if you love what you played in the previous game and want another taste of the wisecracking Gecko for his final outing, then I'd say you're definitely getting your money's worth here. However, if you find some of the more PS1 archaic aspects of the game very clunky, on top of the aforementioned flaws I pointed out in this review, then I'd say approach with caution.
And with that, dudes and dudettes, ladies and gentlemen, we finally come to the end of the Gex series.
The gag series as a whole is one that a lot of people view as a relic of the 90s mascot platformer craze, with a lot of its jokes and references being firmly stuck in the 90s, to the point where this series couldn't possibly have any place in today's world. And to a certain extent, I can see why Gex ended where it did, considering the fact that with a lack of an established cast or developed world of any sort, it really wasn't going to have much longevity in a series that only really exists to parody popular TV shows and movies throughout the years.
But don't get it twisted, that's just my cynical side talking, because now, especially as I started to think about it a little bit more, I think what the Gex series was and what it represented, and where the cultural audience is now in 2019, I do think there is genuinely an equilibrium that can be met between these two audiences.
We live in a day and age of the internet where detached sarcasm and pop culture references are pretty much stock standard towards people's comedic tastes. And from a characterization standpoint, who is Gex exactly? A wisecracking TV-loving lizard who cracks pop culture jokes and goes through levels parodying popular movies and TV shows? Combine that with the 90s as all hell aesthetic, and given the nostalgia craze going on right now for the decade craving 3D platformers to make a return, I think a new Gex game would honestly sell really well in this day and age, a lot better than people might think. The series has a very unique style, balancing comedy with a more intense cyberpunk look, which I think would make it stand out from its more childlike contemporaries in the modern day, as a game that stands up on its own 2 feet.
So I suppose the question now boils down to why Crystal Dynamics didn't develop a Gex game for the PlayStation 2 and Xbox consoles in the early 2000s.
Well, believe it or not, a Gex 4 was actually in development at one point, speculated to be released shortly after Blood Omen 2. As for its cancellation, well, nobody can say for certain why this happened. Some think that maybe when Crystal Dynamics scored the license to Tomb Raider, they put Gex on the back burner to be forgotten about, while others also say that Crystal Dynamics was burned out on the 3D platformer genre by the year 2000, hence why they kind of stopped using Gex as their mascot. Whatever the case might have been, Gex 4 was no more, and all that really remains of the development history is two scraps of concept art left floating about the internet. And it doesn't look like Crystal Dynamics is going to make a return to the series anytime soon, considering their infatuation with Lara Croft, and even now, with the lucrative deal they got with Marvel to produce superhero games, probably because of the success of Insomnia Games when they had the Spider-Man license at their beck and call. Yeah, Gex probably isn't going to see another game in this day and age.
But that's not to say that another developer under Square Enix's belt couldn't take the reins for the Gex series.
I mean, just saying, I think Gex has a place in Kingdom Hearts 4 if Square Enix play their cards right. But on a slightly more serious note, for all the reasons that I mentioned above, Gex has all the potential in the world to make a successful return. It's just a matter of finding a developer who's willing to give the wisecracking lizard a shot.
That being said though, considering how the game ends, is it entirely a bad thing that Gex is kicking back in his retirement?
I mean, take a look at the game's intro for example. The entire vibe of this thing is just the pinnacle of summertime chillaxation, dude. Not to mention, the whole vibe of Gex coming out of retirement to face against Rez one last time, getting the girl with Agent Extra, and by the game's end, well, I'd say the series ended pretty conclusively for a game series that didn't really have much to resolve to begin with.
I mean, just take a look at what the dude has by the end of the series.
He's got a shitload of money, he's got a hot babe, he's chilling out and sunbathing on a serene island beach with vending machines, beer, hot dogs, and television at his beck and call.
Quite frankly, Gex is living the dream, dude, and I'm kind of okay with that.
Don't get it twisted, I would be there day one for a new Gex game if it were to ever happen. But if Gex 3 Deep Cover Gecko is to be the final installment of the Gex series, well then I'm at least glad to see Gex is finally living the dream.
Rocco on Gex, dude. And so, with all that said, dude and dudettes, I am Solidus Skully, keeping new metal. And next time on Skully Reviews, with the Christmas season rolling around, I think it's about time that I fulfilled a promise that I've been trying to fulfill for the past couple of years now. So, next time on Skully Reviews, we're going to be pulling an old war veteran out of retirement for one last mission in Shadow Moses, Solid Snake, starring in Metal Gear Solid. Catch you later, dudes and dudettes, and I will see you for the Christmas season.
Peace.